Hey guys, it's Jacob from Living Healthy Every Day, and we've got a cool podcast for you today. Today we're going to be discussing the truth about iron, copper, calcium, vitamin C, magnesium, and vitamin D. We're going to be talking about a few chronic illnesses like osteoporosis and cancer, and we're going to be discussing some of the mishaps of problems with root canals. So I'm here with cardiologist Dr. Thomas Levy. Thank you for being here, Dr. Levy.
My pleasure, Jacob.
He's a cardiologist, leading research and spokesman of many toxins found in common American diet. He has many publications along with 10 books, and his next book is going to be in about 3 months. He has so much education, certifications, and professional affiliations that it would take up a whole episode to list them all. So I'm just going to let you go to peakenergy.com and check him out there. So let's get started. Let's talk a little bit about the history of iron. So why did they start enriching foods with iron? What's the deal with that?
Well, they haven't admitted it as such, but I believe back in the early 1940s, late 1930s, the public health authorities, quote unquote, in the United States looked at indigent, underfed third world populations of children. And under such a malnourished state, there was a very high incidence of iron deficiency anemia. And in a stroke of utter reverse genius, they decided that, well, we have to make sure that no infant, no child, or no adult for that matter, ever gets iron deficiency anemia in the United States. So they just decided
So they're looking to start, at other countries and
So they just decided to start putting iron with a couple other substances in all the foods that are labeled enriched.
So not bioactive iron.
Right. It doesn't have to say iron enriched. If it says enriched, it has iron added to it.
Enriched in general just means it has iron in it.
That when you see that on any sort of food package, if you see enriched and they don't specify what it's been enriched with, iron is one of those components.
So what are the common foods that have that?
Well,
like baked goods and
just about any food that has anything wheat based. And when you stop and think about it, if there's anything wheat based in it, you have a whole wide variety. You have pastas, you have bread, you have pastries, you have a lot of sauce mixes, and a lot of things where it's just a subtle ingredient. But if it says enriched, or coming from enriched components, it has iron added to it.
So it's excess of iron. So what does iron naturally do in the body? Let's go over that role real quick.
Well, first thing to realize about iron is that it's a micronutrient mineral, not a macro. A macronutrient mineral is something like magnesium. It's very difficult to get too much of magnesium. Iron, on the other hand, even though it's involved in several hundred different important enzymatic and chemical reactions in the body, the primary purpose for iron is to make blood, to help the blood be synthesized. And the blood needs such a large amount of iron, you know automatically that if you have a normal blood count, you have enough iron in your body. And you don't really need to worry about not having enough iron in your body until you actually develop the iron deficiency anemia that was being talked about earlier. And then again, this just makes it all the more tragic that they add iron to our food. If someone does become iron deficient, it's very simple to supplement with them with iron for a limited period of time until they restore their blood count to normal.
So someone who is, I have a client that has Crohn's and they're constantly anemic. Should they supplement with iron, or is it just bad overall to supplement with iron?
You know, it depends on the type of anemia. Again, it has to be an iron deficiency anemia. Somebody with Crohn's may or may not have a macrocytic anemia secondary to the deficiency of other nutrients. Okay. In that case, you don't want to be basically poisoning with iron as well as not addressing the other things that particular anemia needs.
So why does it, what? Oh, what are you saying?
Go ahead. No, go ahead.
So why does iron get high? Other than eating excess iron, why does it get high? Is it like works with pathogens, inflammation? What's up?
Well, really, unless you have a specific disease like hemochromatosis, a genetic problem with dealing with iron metabolism, the only way your iron gets high is by taking in too much. Mm-hmm. Very little iron gets out of your body on a daily basis. So this is what makes the food supplementation with iron so tragic, is that even though it might be a very tiny amount each day, it accumulates. Mm-hmm. And there are very, very, very few adults in the United States or around the world that would truly have a normal ferritin level reflective of a normal iron content. Mm-hmm. In fact, the number of adults that are so overloaded with iron is so high, and it represents such a large percent of the population. LabCorp, which measures, well, obviously, different blood tests, their reference range, I say that because a lot of people call it normal range, their reference range is 30 to 400, okay, nanogram per cc. Well, reference range just means this is the numbers that they've collected statistically. When you look at a normal bell-shaped curve of the population, what do we, and we need to make most of the population normal. That's the reference range. Well, in the case of ferritin, 30 is too high. 30 is too high. You need to be closer to 15 to 20. And when you get even as high as 50 nanogram per cc, there's studies out there. Most docs don't seem to be aware of it. There are studies out there showing already that you're increasing the stiffness of the walls of the arteries, which is a prelude to high blood pressure and other conditions.
So places like LabCorp, they're taking the whole reference range from healthy people and sick people that have really high inflammation and things like that?
Yeah, basically, with the typical bell-shaped curve, when you're like one standard deviation high, one standard deviation low, they're going to make any blood test make roughly, I would say, 80% of the population within the normal range. You know, low normal to mid-range to high normal, but it has nothing to do with any pathology that affects that test. They're just looking at something after the fact. And just, I mean, if your whole population is sick, or more accurately, I guess you could say, if 95% of the population is sick or has an abnormal amount of something that you're measuring, how are you going to figure out by that range what the normal is?
Yeah.
Obviously, you need other research studies, which I've cited in my books, that show these levels of iron, even above minimal elevations, are highly toxic, and it just progressively gets worse the higher it gets. The quote-unquote top normal range of LabCorp of 400 nanogram per cc is astronomical.
And
you better have your cardiologist on call so he doesn't get delayed or she doesn't get delayed seeing you in the emergency room.
Yeah. So we're talking about we're talking about having high iron. So what are the diseases that are correlated with high iron?
Well, high iron increases oxidative stress throughout your body, in all of your cells and in the extracellular space. Increased oxidative stress is the final common denominator as the reflection of and direct cause of disease, okay? Mm-hmm. The more chronic oxidative stress, increased oxidative stress you have in a certain tissue, the more that tissue is going to be diseased. So the direct answer to your question is increase iron levels, increase your chance of and the degree of disease in all cells of your body, so all diseases. And the higher your iron level gets, the greater your chances of dying from any cause. In other words, that's called an increase in all-cause mortality.
Yeah, yeah. So what about iron binding to pathogens? Or do they accumulate with pathogens, infections?
It's interesting. Pathogens, mainly bacteria, but other pathogens as well. Pathogens and cancer cells, interestingly enough, both avidly accumulate iron. And in fact, it can well be said that iron is the fuel that causes pathogens to proliferate and causes cancer cells to proliferate. And when in fact you use, you know, experimentally, if you will, in different studies, you use different ways of getting iron out of cells. Mm-hmm. You decrease the degree of malignancy. Sometimes you revert the path, the type of cell to normal or less malignant. And when you use iron chelators in infections, you start controlling the infection much more readily. As a matter of fact, very interesting thing I stumbled across in all my research was that many of the most effective antibiotics actually are also iron chelators. So you take the antibiotic and you chelate or bind up the iron that's available, and for lack of a better word, the pathogen doesn't proliferate, starves, and eventually dies.
Is that using the Fenton reaction?
Well, no. This would be the exact opposite of the Fenton reaction. When you take iron out of the cell, you're not going to have increased oxidative stress anymore. And when you take iron away from the pathogen, it doesn't proliferate anymore. But when you give iron, yes, you give iron, you increase the activity of the Fenton reaction, which produces a highly pro-oxidant substance called the hydroxyl radical, and that massively increases oxidative stress inside the affected cell, whether it's a normal cell or a cancer cell.
And so with taking like some like vitamin C, would that help donate the electron to hydrogen peroxide, to create hydrogen peroxide?
Well, actually, the intracellular environment of a cancer cell is characterized by two things. There's a high level of iron present, mm-hmm. and there's a high level of peroxide present because for some reason in cancer cells, the enzyme catalase is very depressed, and catalase is a natural thing that keeps peroxide levels low. So you have a setting where there's increased iron, increased peroxide. This is the basic primordial soup from which the Fenton reaction just takes off. Now, when you take a chemotherapy agent, this is strongly pro-oxidative. It stimulates the Fenton reaction further, and it will kill the cancer cells that it goes into. Unfortunately, chemotherapy is non-specifically pro-oxidant and causes damage to all the other normal cells. Mm-hmm. When you take vitamin C in a cancer patient, the vitamin C, of course, is an electron donor. Inside the cell, using the iron, you have what's called ferric iron 3+ and ferrous iron 2+. The ferric iron has one less electron than the ferrous iron. So the vitamin C will come in and act as chemotherapy for that cancer cell, not for regular cells, because it will donate its electron to Fe3+, make it Fe2+. And now the Fe2+ is capable of relaying that electron directly to peroxide, which then splits into the hydroxyl radical and causes the profound oxidative stress inside the cell. But since normal cells don't have the elevated iron, they don't have the elevated peroxide, vitamin C just nurtures those cells. So that's the big difference.
So chemotherapy attacks all the cells, and vitamin C just attacks the cancer cells.
That's correct. Yes, sir.
Okay. So when chemotherapy happens and you get lysing, like the rupture of the cell, that's releasing iron into the blood, right? Excess iron into the blood?
It's releasing a ton of iron into the blood. And it's so all very, very elemental, very pro-oxidative.
A lot of cancer patients who get chemotherapy get flu-like symptoms and nauseous and sick. Is that the reason why? Because of the excess iron in the blood? Or is it just because it's a poison?
It's a very good thought, Jacob, and the answer, I'm sure, is both, okay?
Yeah.
The chemotherapy is profoundly pro-oxidant to all the cells, but if it's being effective in killing a significant number of cancer cells, you will get a relatively acute phase of feeling lousy, much like a flu-like syndrome, called a Herxheimer-like reaction.
Yeah, Herxing.
And the other thing, too, and so you're releasing all the metabolic products inside the cell, all of which are pro-oxidant. You're also releasing a large amount of iron. And they now have studies that show this increase in iron after lysis of cancer cells inside the body can persist for up to 2 weeks. So just because you get the patient through the first few days, you can still help them a lot if you're not inclined to supplement them for the rest of their life to get their antioxidant levels up high for at least the first 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm. So something like liposomal vitamin C or intravenous, something like that?
Liposomal vitamin C, intravenous vitamin C. Not everybody can get a hold of liposome C or get access to an IV. So people should understand, too, that they could just buy, still fairly cheap, who knows what the future holds, but you could buy sodium ascorbate powder, which is easier on the stomach than ascorbic acid powder. They mm-hmm. both have ascorbate. They're both vitamin C. And you just figure out over time what your bowel tolerance dose is. In other words, how much can I take in divided doses short of developing diarrhea?
Yeah, my bowel tolerance is very low for it.
Some people very high. Some cancer patients might need 30, 40 grams before they reach bowel tolerance. And if whatever dose of vitamin C powder they're taking has not reached that point, that's a soft indication of how much more vitamin C they need.
Mm-hmm. So vitamin C, liposomal vitamin C, does that create bowel tolerance?
No, there's no bowel tolerance with liposomes because—
And not with intravenous either, because it doesn't—
And not with intravenous, okay. That's correct, yes.
Okay, I want to get back to vitamin C a little bit later. I still want to talk about iron. So iron, it causes inflammation. It can it's linked to heart disease, right? What about, how does it affect the gut?
Iron?
Iron in the gut.
Yes, okay. Excuse me. Just getting over a cold. I usually keep the cough much longer than the cold. Iron, first of all, we didn't mention one thing. Let's mention it right now.
Sure.
The supplementation in enriched foods of iron, in many cases, not 100%, but in the majority of cereals and other such things, cream of wheat, all these things, they not only have iron added, they have metallic iron, iron filings. Which is metal, okay?
Yes, that's metal.
Okay, this is going into your system from the moment you're an infant and take your first sip or suck of enriched formula, and continues until
it's in formula. Okay, wow.
Yes. I mean, we start it right away.
Mm-hmm.
So, metallic iron has its effect, and supplemental iron. Both have the same effect, except that the metallic iron can also cause what's called a foreign body reaction inside your intestine, too. But bottom line is, we just discussed this with the Fenton reaction,
mm-hmm.
iron in any form is highly pro-oxidant. When you oxidize something severely, you inflame it. Inflammation is a synonym, basically means the same thing as increased oxidative stress. You could basically use inflammation and increased oxidative stress interchangeably. So inflammation is the basic thing that's called leaky gut.
Mm-hmm.
So from day one, you progressively take more iron, you progressively get more inflammation of your gut, and then lo and behold, I mean, when I was a kid, I didn't know anybody with a peanut allergy.
Yeah,
okay.
It's definitely on the rise now.
Because, I mean, the number of kids that drop dead of peanut allergies is mind-boggling. Now, I don't know how long the gluten sensitivity thing has been high, but I do know that since 1941, when iron was introduced to foods, celiac disease, which is the most advanced form of gluten sensitivity, has increased 400%.
Mm-hmm.
So you got to remember, gluten is a protein. Okay, peanuts is a combination of a large number of different proteins. And if your gut's not leaky and your digestion is forming right, no antigenic part of gluten or peanuts ever get into your system and you never develop an allergy.
Mm-hmm.
So I would submit to you, there are a lot of things that damage our gut these days, lots of things, okay? I think based on what I've been talking about, iron is one of the big things. Mm-hmm. Okay. I had a gluten allergy. I had a severe arthritis in my thumb that was going on for 3 years. I mean, wow. I did everything imaginable.
Yeah.
And I read about gluten and I went on a gluten-free diet. And a week later, it stopped hurting. I said, this is unbelievable. 3 months later, I got bored with the diet. I ate some more gluten. That night, the finger hurt again. I said, okay,
there you go.
I understand. But 3 months later, I got bored again. And I went back to eating a little gluten, like the bun in a hamburger. No problem. Now, and I've had no problem since then on what I call a gluten-light diet. Okay? Mm-hmm. That was several years ago. Now, the point to be taken from that is gluten-free foods are almost always iron-free foods.
So they're not enriched.
They're not enriched. And same thing with organic foods. Mm-hmm. So, but going on the gluten-free diet inadvertently, without me realizing it, stopped me from hitting my intestine every day with iron. And over a six-month period, my gut was able to heal. And once the gut has healed, it can once again, if you can get good healing. I'm not saying everybody out there that's has a peanut allergy.
I know you take a lot of antioxidants. You're big in the antioxidants, so that will help.
And all that helps inflammation. But the point being is once you get a healed gut, it can digest any protein that comes in, whether it's a peanut or whether it's gluten. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't want people to re-challenge themselves or anything like that. I'm just saying it appears to me that if you have at least a mild, maybe a moderate gluten sensitivity, this can be resolved if you could eliminate the iron in your diet for a long enough period of time.
Yeah, I've noticed the same thing.
I would never suggest to a peanut allergic kid mm-hmm. that you should ever get near peanuts again. But I think this could probably resolve that allergy too. And if you had a doctor that was motivated and willing to do testing, you know, you could find out. But I mean, when your life is threatened, no one food is that important. So I would say once have a peanut allergy, treat yourself always as though you have a peanut allergy, even if you can do something to make your gut heal.
Yeah, I've noticed I have a light gluten sensitivity as well. I've noticed being gluten-free and eating organically, like consistently, has really helped my exposure to cross-contamination and things like that, where I don't get sick as I used to. So
both of those two things, organic and gluten-free, almost eliminates the added iron. I say almost because you still need to read the label. I would say roughly, for God knows what reason, 5 to 10% of gluten-free things, if you read the label, they still have added iron. And 5 to 10% of organic that you don't want anything messing with it still has a little iron added. So read the labels.
Yeah, it's a good idea to always read it, even if you have a sensitivity to anything. So it's causing inflammation. It's causing damage to the liver as well. What about the thyroid?
Well, you know, once you screw up digestion, you screw up everything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're letting in big proteins get into.
Not only that, you're having poor digestion. Much of your food is putrefying rather than digesting. These cause a proliferation of horribly toxic microbes, pathogens in your gut. Mm-hmm. They secrete exotoxins. They form endotoxins. And, you know, I've come to some realization, it shouldn't be that profound, but that so many different things can be resolved by good nutrition. But the big deal is, how do you get good nutrition? And the problem is, and I say this in a lot of my presentations, a lot of people think if they just have an organic food diet, they're fine. Well, organic foods are better than the alternative, which is foods filled with toxins.
Yeah.
But if you don't have any idea about the concepts about how to support good digestion, that organic food is going to do you little good. I like to say, an organic diet digested poorly is vastly more toxic to you than a McDonald's diet digested perfectly.
Yeah.
Okay, because your gut produces more potent and higher amounts of toxins from poor digestion, regardless of the source of the food. Mm-hmm. Okay, and the things that are important are the liquids not too much fluid with meals, the digestive enzymes. We get old, we stop making them. We still need them. Very important, and in some arenas, including nutrition arenas, they either claim ignorance or they actively make fun of this, food combining, okay? We were not designed to eat four or five foods at once, at least from the point of view of digestion. Mm-hmm. The Russian physiologist Ivan Pavlov, who won the Nobel Prize in the early part of the late 1900s, was a digestive physiologist, and he got the idea. He wanted to see what foods did to digestion, so he had a dog stomach prep, live dogs, kind of gruesome, but he would put starch in the belly, in the stomach by itself. The starch would pass through the pylorus into the intestine in 60 to 90 minutes. Then he put up by itself ground chips of beef in the stomach. That was longer, took a while longer, took 3 hours. Mm-hmm. Then he got the bright idea to put the starch and the meat. Does that sound familiar, like a steak and potatoes?
Exactly,
put the starch and the meat together in the stomach. How long do you think it took for the stomach to
Probably way longer, because you got the hydrochloric acid and then you got the base trying to work together.
9 hours.
9 hours, wow.
So you have totally screwed up digestion from the moment it goes down into your stomach when you combine foods like that.
Yeah.
Okay. The problem is we simply eat culturally. Mm-hmm. Okay. We eat without any knowledge at all as to what supports good digestive physiology. Mm-hmm. And milk is bad for its calcium, but you drink milk with a meal, you zap the digestion. You drink alcohol with a meal, you zap the digestion. So you go out and you have your steak and potato and a glass of wine. I mean, you ever wonder why after a meal like that you wake up in the middle of the night with a stomach ache?
So you want to do proper food combining, essentially.
Proper food combining, yes.
So you eat your proteins separate, maybe with a vegetable.
That's correct.
And then you eat fruits alone, right?
Right.
Fruits are meant to be eaten alone. And
you know, I mean, it's tough to summarize in a few words, except to say that your best diet would be, if you're into breakfast, you know, maybe have an omelet, but don't have any bread with it.
Yeah.
You know, and don't wash it down with a lot of fluid. Have the cheese, have the egg, eat that, and try to break the idea that you got to wash everything down.
Well, that's my idea on why we have so many digestive enzymes now. Everyone needs digestive enzymes to process things. It's because we're constantly drinking water with our meals.
Well, that's true, too, except in older individuals, they do start declining in their ability to produce sufficient enzymes for a given. So you're correct, but there's the added factor of not making much, not making sufficient when you get older. Mm-hmm.
So I want to go back to iron. So if you have high iron, other than eliminating iron or enriched foods and eating organically and gluten-free, what else can you do? Like donating blood, I know, is huge to try to reduce that.
Phlebotomy, you know, given a unit of blood, usually they limit you to once every 2 months. If you give a unit of blood, and of course they check you to make sure your blood count's not too low. You can't give blood if you're anemic. Giving blood every 2 months will be the quickest way to get iron out of your body, mm-hmm. and a very safe way. Okay, taking the blood is very quick and dramatic, but your body equilibrates over that 2 month period. Now, if you have an extremely high level of ferritin, and you have an unstable illness that you feel is the iron is strongly contributing to, and you don't have months to a year to get the iron level down, mm-hmm. then you can go for a prescription iron chelator. However, I think in most cases, prescription chelators are really never indicated if you just take something called inositol hexaphosphate.
It's IP6.
All right.
Yeah.
And
what's that? That's phytic acid?
That's phytic acid, but bound with phytic acid has 12 hydrogens on it. Sodium phytate has 12 sodiums on it. Mm-hmm. IP6 has the phytate with generally coming from food sources, 4 calciums and 2 magnesiums. And some people might say, wow, I don't want to take something with calcium. And Dr. Levy, don't you advise against taking something with calcium? Well, the fact of the matter is the phytate holds on tight to the calcium, just donates the magnesium, and then the two remaining sites that the magnesium come off of avidly bind calcium and iron. Mm-hmm. Okay, and there's many, many studies to show that you drop your iron levels very nicely with IP6. You also pull calcium out, which is desirable in the vast majority of people as well. The important thing is, though, it loves to bind minerals. In fact, it comes out of food, and you don't take it with a meal. You don't take it any time at all. You take it when your stomach is empty. So the best thing you do... I mean, you just have your glass of water and your capsule sitting right by your bedside. That's going to be the emptiest your stomach's going to be all day. Mm-hmm. Okay, so you just take it first thing in the morning on an empty stomach. So, there also, you have the far infrared sauna, which is okay. Very good for getting out iron.
Is that you're sweating it out? Is that what's happening?
You're sweating it out. I mean, we know endurance athletes.
So exercise could do it too.
Well, really vigorous exercise, okay, really enough vigorous. To cause the sweat. The important part is the sweat.
Mm-hmm.
And endurance athletes who sweat a ton, in one study, were shown to get their ferritin levels down to as low as 12 without an iron deficiency anemia.
Really?
So,
wow.
So we recommend 15 to 25, but don't feel like you're hurting yourself if your ferritin levels go super low as long as you have a normal blood count.
Mm-hmm. What about something like hot yoga? That would also make you sweat.
I'm not sure what hot yoga is, Jacob.
There's things like Bikram where it's like 100 degrees at 40% humidity, and you really sweat.
Well, anything that causes you to sweat.
Anything that causes you to sweat.
Okay, so it sounds like that would.
Yeah. What about taking like turmeric, curcumin? Doesn't that inhibit the absorption of iron?
I don't know the answer to that,
Jake. From the studies I've seen, it does. But yeah.
There's a lot of things that have different effects. And I'm not saying there might not be something out there that I haven't covered, but these are the best ways to significantly and fairly quickly reduce iron. Now, you know, there might have some supplements that have an effect, but I don't know that the curcumin and turmeric, you know, if they do take out a lot of iron, that could explain in many ways much of their positive activity.
It's anti-inflammatory activity.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, what happens when you take iron out? You reduce inflammation. Yeah. You reduce oxidative stress.
That's
so
true.
I don't want to say. I mean, it sounds good, and I think we're figuring out a mechanism as we talk here.
So, what you should eat organic. You should eat gluten free. Eating meats and veggies are fine.
That's correct.
Just not eating enriched cereals, enriched foods, anything like that. We want to stay
That's
away
correct.
From that.
Okay,
That's and,
correct.
And supplementation is bad unless you're anemic. Iron
With
anemic.
Iron
anemic.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
That's
Let's
right.
Talk about copper, because I know that's a problem. Like, it's correlated. Like, with Wilson, some people have a genetic predisposition to accumulate excess copper. So can you have a copper deficiency? Like, supplementing copper, do you need to?
No, you never need to supplement copper. And it has the same relative toxicity as iron. You know, there's a lot of studies out there that are just looking at a isolated system and say, oh, if you take too much of this one supplement, you push the copper down. Well, believe me, if anything you do pushes the copper down, that's a positive, because there's never been identified, to my knowledge, a single case report of anybody with a documented copper deficiency.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it is a micro mineral in terms of what you need inside your body. It also upregulates the Fenton reaction, like iron that we talked about.
Mm-hmm.
When you look at atherosclerotic plaques, they have high iron and copper levels in them. When you look at cancer patients, they have high circulating levels of copper and iron. And just as ferritin increasing ferritin is directly associated with an increased all-cause mortality. Same thing for copper. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I would say never supplement copper. A lot of people might take a big multivitamin, multimineral, and say they feel better, and it's got calcium, iron, and copper in it. Well, I mean, if you have something where 15 of the components are good for you and three are bad, you're really in a position to say that the iron, the copper, and the calcium weren't bad for you? No, you're just ready to say that the net effect was I felt good, but not realizing that you're still accumulating iron, accumulating calcium, and accumulating copper, so it can drop the other shoe on you down the road.
So what about taking zinc to try to balance that out?
Zinc is fine. Zinc is an excellent mineral, very good in its anti-infection properties. Mm-hmm. Okay,
and it's actually antimicrobial.
When you have even whether you're supplementing it regularly or not, it's always a good thing to acutely give a large dose to when you're trying to deal with any acute or chronic infection. So no, it's not in the same category as the toxic trio.
Oh, that's cool. So copper, I wonder if copper is correlated with, I haven't done the research on this yet, but if it's correlated with Parkinson's disease, because you have vitamin C plus copper increase the enzymatic function of dopamine beta hydroxylase, which converts dopamine into noradrenaline, norepinephrine. So I wonder if it's having high copper is just getting through that dopamine a lot faster. Have you seen any studies, something like that?
No, and that's not to say that's not correct. I'm saying I haven't seen the studies. however, it's important to remember with both Parkinson's and Alzheimer's, mm-hmm. and probably all the other neurodegenerative diseases as well, the higher your pathogen load in the body is, the more advanced those diseases get. Pathogen load meaning infected teeth, infected tonsils, infected gums, perhaps a focal infection somewhere else in your body you're not aware of, infections in your gut. All of these things, focal infections, feed and help contribute to a generalized increased state of oxidative stress in the body. And for reasons unclear, because, I mean, if you give a large amount of a wide variety of toxins to 100 people, you're not going to get the same disease. Mm-hmm. You're going to get, 30 of this, 25 of that, 18 of that.
Diseases are multifactorial.
It's multifactorial, but people are different. Yeah. People have different susceptibilities. Mm-hmm. So you give the same toxin load to one 65-year-old, he develops Parkinson's. To another one, he develops high blood pressure and gets a heart attack. To another one, he gets chronic arthritis. We know that this increased oxidative stress causes all of these diseases, exacerbates all these diseases, and accelerates your way to the grave, but we have no idea why certain toxins seem to cause one disease in one person and another disease in another.
Mm-hmm. So was like calcium contributes to that, right? Is one of the many factors. I know you have a book, it's Death by Calcium, right?
That's correct, yes.
So what kind of diseases are linked to like high levels of calcium?
All of them.
All of them.
Okay. All diseases, 100%, have increased oxidative stress inside the affected cells. Mm-hmm. Okay. A different disease is going to be a different variety of tissues and cells. But in the affected cells, 100% of those cells have increased calcium intracellularly. And when you take measures to get calcium out of the body, such as with high-dose magnesium, even vitamin C, mm-hmm. Vitamin K, these things not only make you better, they decrease all-cause mortality. Now, how can taking something, any one thing, decrease your chance of heart disease, decrease your chance of neurological disease, help your liver disease. I mean, if it does all of those things, it's because of one thing. It's because all of the cells have a common pathology. Mm-hmm. And you're improving that common pathology and ameliorating whatever your disease is, because all diseases are increased oxidative stress.
Yeah. So what about like supplementing calcium? So that's bad. Like people supplement it for osteopenia, osteoporosis.
Calcium is a primary carcinogen.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Everybody has, or well over 90% of all adults have calcium excess in their bodies.
Mm-hmm.
You have osteoporosis, you don't have enough calcium in your bones, but you don't have the other structural components of bones as well. So osteoporosis is not pathologically a calcium deficiency of your bones. It's a deficiency of the entire matrix in the bone, mm-hmm. okay? And not only does taking calcium not build new bone and not decrease your chance of osteoporosis fractures, which mm-hmm. should be the ultimate goal of taking calcium for osteoporosis, is to make you less likely to have a fracture, it vastly increases your chance of heart attack and cancer.
So that's increasing calcium everywhere, and it's getting into the bone, but it's not decreasing the fracture amount of fractures?
Right. I liken it, I use the analogy of taking calcium to get into your bones, because it will technically make the number on a bone density test better. So the doctors are given calcium and they're looking at the test and say, oh, your bone is more dense. Well, it's the same thing as putting white paint on a rotting fence.
You can't see underneath.
Okay. The fence looks a little bit better, but you lean against it, it still breaks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what do you do if you have osteoporosis, like vitamin D?
The big four.
The big four?
I mean, there's a lot of things to do. The big four. And this applies not only to osteoporosis, but I call these the big four supplements for whatever it is you want to do to support good health.
Mm-hmm.
Magnesium, number one. Magnesium, number one. That's coming from the vitamin C man. Magnesium is number one.
So what is magnesium doing in the body?
Magnesium is the primary antagonist, yin and yang, to calcium.
Mm-hmm.
The higher you get your calcium, your magnesium levels, the lower you push your calcium. And you start pushing calcium out, okay? Mm-hmm. Magnesium, vitamin C, vitamin D, and vitamin K. Interesting thing now, those four things that I just mentioned, they've done studies on all four of them. And when you look at the effects of just one supplement mm-hmm. on the patients that you're dealing with, each one individually decreases all-cause mortality.
Wow.
And they do that because they all affect calcium metabolism and calcium regulation and calcium being the primary abnormality of all chronically inflamed cells that have increased oxidative stress.
Wow, that makes sense. So how is vitamin C working on calcium?
Vitamin C actually helps mobilize calcium in some old studies, but old doesn't mean bad.
Mm-hmm.
They actually looked in the laboratory, not inside the body, and when they took, found that calcium could be dissolved, put into solution more effectively by ascorbic acid
mm-hmm.
than by the other most potent inorganic acids that we know of, like hydrochloric acid, sulfuric mm-hmm. acid. Vitamin C put calcium into solution better than those acids.
Wow.
So vitamin C is a calcium solubilizer. I mean, it puts it into solution and then it can be circulated, part of which can be excreted.
Mm-hmm. So I want to talk a little bit about vitamin C. So what? So that you have liposomes, and
right.
you can make liposomal vitamin C. What is so great about liposoming something, if that's a term?
No, that's as good a way as anyone, you know, liposoming it or putting it in a liposome. The whole point of language is communication. As long as you communicate right. the idea, that's what's important.
You understand me. Hopefully the audience understands me too.
Now, liposomes, the first thing to understand about a liposome is, in every sense of the word, it's an artificial cell. Okay? Mm-hmm. And in fact, the body has many liposome-like substances that the cells produce, and the only difference of them is how big or how small they are, that actually, in some cases, get waste products out of the cell, mm-hmm. okay? In other circumstances, it encapsulates certain factors inside the cell and allows them to be transported through the body and get inside another cell. So the liposome is imitating the natural messengers inside the body that not only transmit chemical reactions, but they also, if you will, for lack of a better term, inform a remote cell of what's going on in another part of the body.
So it can easily cross the cell membrane?
When they're of the proper size, okay? The commercial ones produced by Livon Labs are between 100 and 200 nanometer, mm-hmm. okay? But the really big important thing is we always just think of bioavailability as getting into the blood. Mm-hmm. Getting into the blood is only the start. Getting into the blood gives you no guarantee of how efficiently you're going to get inside the cell. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, with a liposome encapsulated vitamin C, and I might add the cell wall of the liposome is identical to the cell wall of normal cells. So same thing, mm-hmm. same phospholipids. Well, these things are absorbed almost 100%, so nothing gets down into the bowel. Because they're fat rather than protein or carbohydrate, they don't go into the portal vein system and get hit by the liver. They go directly into the ileals, which are the equivalent of the capillaries inside the lymphatic system. They go straight into the ileals, immediately face a large amount of immune cells, so they can immediately start putting their contents into the immune cells and supercharging your white cells. Mm-hmm. The main way a macrophage or white cell kills is by how much vitamin C it has inside it. Then those that don't go inside those immune cells goes through the lymphatic system, goes out of the thoracic duct in the neck, and then into the bloodstream. Mm-hmm. But they're going into the bloodstream now as liposomes. They're not going into the bloodstream as naked vitamin C. In the liposome form, then it goes to the cell, and it either passes through the large pores of the cell directly, allowing it to give its contents not only the cytoplasm, but also the mitochondria, the nucleus, the endoplasmic reticulum. Others
That's awesome.
hit the cell wall, and then by a process called reverse pinocytosis, just merge into the cell wall and then deposit their contents. Mm-hmm. However, and I'm not putting down intravenous vitamin C. That does many wonderful things. I tell people when you're sick and you can get a hold of it, take lipo, take regular, and take IVC. But when you put vitamin C directly into the blood, unencapsulated, mm-hmm. the vitamin C that's powerful, the reduced vitamin C, needs an active transport mechanism to get inside the cell. So you're robbing Peter to pay Paul. You're using energy to put up an energy-providing substance
to the cell. So it's using up ATP?
Yes, indirectly. Also, the dehydroascorbic acid that's part of the IV, which is the oxidized vitamin C, this will pass through the cell without the consumption of energy. Mm-hmm. But it's oxidized. So in order to have it reduced again, you have to consume energy. So even though you're given intravenously, you're having to consume energy to get the target molecule where you want. Mm-hmm. And this is why this is especially true with liposome glutathione. To get glutathione inside the cell without consuming energy like liposomes does is phenomenal. Because when you give glutathione intravenously, and that has a lot of good indications, Parkinson's, etc., when you're giving intravenously, it's a tripeptide. The moment it hits the blood, it gets broken into three individual amino acids mm-hmm. very quickly.
Yeah.
Then, to get those three amino acids inside the cell, you got to use energy three times. Mm-hmm. And once you have the three three amino acids inside the cell, you have two more ATP-dependent enzymes to resynthesize glutathione. So you use up energy up so five energy. Times. Okay. I originally became affiliated with Live On Labs that makes the liposomes almost 11 years ago now, mm-hmm. because I saw it do things clinically under certain circumstances that I didn't even see IV vitamin C do. So I said, wow, something's going on here, and I need to learn about what a liposome is.
Mm-hmm. So doing liposomal glutathione is going to use a lot less energy.
Absolutely. I mean, I try every time I'm at a conference to get the doctors that are treating Parkinson's and getting their good results with IV glutathione. I said, for goodness sakes, have them take two or three packets of the liposomal. I promise you they'll do better. Maybe I'll eventually get that feedback, but I don't have it right now.
So you can't just liposome everything because that's going to make anything absorb better, even toxins, right?
Yeah. No, I mean, that's which is a good point. You have to understand physiology. And yes, I mean, liposomes could be a potent stealth source of toxins. Yeah. So, I mean, if you liposome encapsulated arsenic or something like that, I suspect one or two packets would kill somebody very quickly because you're directly putting the toxin inside the cells. So you obviously need to start with something that is beneficial to all the cells, mm-hmm. which, you know, brings us back to nutrients and antioxidants. Even some things that might be good for some cells aren't necessarily good for other cells. So you have to, you know, do a little time, do a little due diligence and good research. You know, it's very clear that vitamin C, glutathione, the B vitamins, antioxidants like alpha lipoic acid, acetyl-carnitine, these are all things that all the cells love.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So vitamin C and glutathione, they work really well synergistically. One's inside the cell, one goes intracellularly, and the other one hangs outside.
Vitamin C goes everywhere, but glutathione is the highest concentration antioxidant inside the cell.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and yes, one regenerates the other. It's interesting point about glutathione that's unlike almost all the other antioxidants is when an antioxidant like vitamin C is oxidized, it's looking for another electron to get back again. So, mm-hmm. in that sense of the word, the vitamin C is temporarily toxic because it's looking to oxidize. On the other hand, it's very important inside the cell to minimize any oxidative stress. Well, glutathione, when you oxidize it, it basically forms a molecule that does not have any pro-oxidant property.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it just stays quiescent.
Until you reduce it
and bring it back to potent glutathione. Okay. So it's nature is pretty interesting in that regard. I mean, it's still an antioxidant, but it appears to be unable to cause or provoke oxidative reactions when it's been used up. When it's been depleted of its electrons, mm-hmm. which is very unique as an antioxidant.
So how can you boost your own glutathione levels, like taking selenium, right?
I'm not familiar with selenium doing it, but okay. I mean whey protein.
Oh yeah, whey is good for it too.
Mm-hmm. And acetylcysteine.
Mm-hmm.
These are all very good supplements, probably primarily because they support glutathione levels. And glutathione is... all antioxidants are antitoxic, but glutathione appears to be especially effective in detoxifying and helping to eliminate toxins that are newly encountered by the cell.
Mm-hmm. So I want to go back to vitamin C a little bit. As an antioxidant, and you said it mobilizes the immune system. Is it increasing B cell function, T cell function?
Well, vitamin C has many different documented positive effects on the immune system.
Mm-hmm.
However, one thing to remember is Recall, all disease is increased oxidation, mm-hmm. and all effective disease treatment is ultimately rendered by delivering an antioxidant impact. Now, there's a lot of different ways to do that, but the final common denominator is you increase antioxidant impact in presence where there's excess oxidation. That's the goal when you're treating something like this.
So is it increasing electrons? Is that what you're doing?
With regard, are you talking about a detox reaction or something like that?
Yeah.
Because you see, vitamin C only reduces. So what happens when you reduce something and you donate the electrons to a detoxification enzyme that had been oxidized? You regenerate and restore the natural function of that detoxification enzyme, and then all of a sudden you can start detoxifying, getting rid of toxins. So this is confused in the literature. A lot of people talk about vitamin C being a chelator. It's not a chelator. Mm-hmm. Okay, a chelator is something that, chelate means claw, binds to something, and then together they get excreted in the urine. The vitamin C, however, doesn't bind anything, but it does bring back to life, if you will, a lot of previously oxidized biomolecules that then start doing their job.
Yeah. So I want to go back to inflammation here. You have a book called The Toxic Truth.
The Toxic Tooth.
The Toxic Tooth. Not it is the truth.
It is true.
So what's going on there? There's increased inflammation from our teeth. You should stay away from root canals. How is it linked to heart attacks and breast cancer?
Okay. Well, the latest study, and I say latest, this is actually 2013 now, mm-hmm. Looked at patients having heart attacks. And the cardiologist did angiograms, and they did a process where they suctioned out the platelet blood clot that had acutely blocked off the artery. Usually there's some atherosclerosis, an enlargement of a plaque, but what causes the heart attack is when it blocks off completely and suddenly, and that's usually caused by platelet stickiness and the platelet blocking off the blood vessel. Mm-hmm. Well, they suctioned out these platelet blood clots, sent it to a laboratory that had a polymerase chain reaction, PCR testing, that can detect minute amounts of nucleic acid, DNA, RNA. Mm-hmm. Well, they found that in over 80% of these clots, they saw the typical pathogens found inside a root canal. And they found 30%, that's 110%, they found 30% had the pathogens typical for periodontal disease. The point is, you put all that together and you can readily see that over 90% of blood clots causing a heart attack are directly caused by the pathogens found in the mouth, very commonly in the gums and inside root canals. Now, before somebody says, oh no, that's just a relation, that's a correlation, that's a link. No, the concentration of the DNA pathogen inside these platelet blood clots was 1,600% more concentrated than in the blood.
Oh my God.
So does that mean a sterile platelet clot developed and then all of a sudden the pathogens come swarming into it? No, it clotted because the pathogens were there. Mm-hmm. So this is our smoking gun cause and effect study that shows infections in the mouth, especially root canals, primarily cause over 90% of all heart attacks. Now, this was published in Circulation, the main journal of cardiologists, and I still have yet to run into a cardiologist that even thinks or cares to have his patients evaluated by the dentist.
Yeah, so if you have a problem, you should be going, if you have inflammation, which is a clear sign of...
in the coronary arteries, heart disease is... coronary artery disease, blockages, atherosclerosis, is always predated by inflammation of the arteries, mm-hmm, inflammation of the inner lining. Okay? And for some reason, my fellow cardiologists stop at this layer of the onion. It's kind of like, well, some people get inflammation of their arteries and atherosclerosis develops. Well, why did they develop inflammation?
Look at the cause.
Okay.
Yeah.
And they developed inflammation, the next layer of the onion, because the pathogens from the mouth selectively seed in the coronary arteries. There's a reason for this, but they selectively seed in the coronary arteries. As they proliferate, they use up all the vitamin C. Mm-hmm. Okay, and when you have no vitamin C, you have huge increased oxidative stress, and I think we said earlier, increased oxidative stress is inflammation.
Mm-hmm.
Very interesting point. The first cells that come to the coronary arteries when this inflammation develops are monocytes.
Mm-hmm.
Monocytes have 8,000%
mm-hmm.
more vitamin C inside them than the plasma. They are literally vitamin C delivery systems.
Wow.
So that's what's attracted to the vitamin C depleted area of inflammation in your coronary arteries or monocytes.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the pathogens stay, so the inflammation and the vitamin C depletion never resolves, and this continuing onslaught by the immune system, along with the other things that help build the plaque, eventually grow the atherosclerosis.
So would taking liposomal vitamin C or IV vitamin C, just taking vitamin C, help with that? Help with the plaque?
It helps a lot of people. It helps a lot of people. Obviously, if you're having a problem in your mouth that's causing these pathogens to be released into your bloodstream.
An infection in your mouth of some sort?
An infection in your mouth.
Mm-hmm.
An asymptomatic infected tooth, a root canal, or advanced gum disease.
So what's the problem with root canals? They're not actually fixing anything, just the pain?
Well, all root canals, 100% are infected,
mm-hmm.
okay? A successful root canal, quote-unquote, is one that has no pain and one that is sealed well enough so that by x-ray it's not continuing to cause visible collections of pus and infection at the apex of the tooth. These root canals in many people appear to be a good treatment.
Mm-hmm.
I would never recommend a root canal to somebody at this point in time because we don't have the studies to clearly show which root canals are bad and which are okay. Because you have a 90-year-old that's had root canals for a couple decades and he's doing great, and you have a 55-year-old that gets a root canal and they have a heart attack 6 months later.
Yeah.
What we do know is that when you have, and this is a statistical study, when you have one or more root canals in your mouth, you have a greater chance of a heart attack. That's just clear and clean cut, okay? But it doesn't address whether a certain subset of root canals might not have that effect, and other root canals that have large areas of infection on x-ray still present do have that effect. So we need more information. The endodontist might be able to breathe a sigh of relief that me, along with Dr. Huggins, some of the most anti-root canal people on the planet, I can't speak for Dr. Huggins, unfortunately he's passed, but there is now information that does indicate some root canals do not undermine your health. But there's a lot of ifs right now that have not been resolved by properly done studies. And so I would still tell somebody, if you have an option other than a root canal, take it.
Mm-hmm.
Even if it just means extraction of the tooth.
So is a root canal, it's not fixing any of the problem. It's just fixing the pain. You still have problems. So you have problems with blood flow after that, right? To the jaw?
Well, it attempts to do two things. It attempts to eliminate the pain.
Yeah.
And it attempts to evacuate out the pulp and fill it with a sealant.
Mm-hmm.
And if it's done well enough, the ongoing infection doesn't continue to ooze around the tip. Because once you get pockets of infection around the tip, every time you chew down, you squeeze those toxins and pathogens into your system, into the venous system, into the lymphatic system. But it does appear, and I wouldn't have been able to say this a few years ago, it does appear that some root canals were done with a lot of expertise, sealed very well, and without x-ray evidence of accumulating new infection, for some people can be very good. We just don't know yet because we need more studies. One important thing to take away from this, though, is, I mean, I chastise the general dentists who are doing root canals that do two or three a week. You should stop the procedure completely and let the endodontists who do 30 a week do all the root canals, because getting this procedure done correctly is very experience related. So a lot of dentists that do that, they're not going to do it. They're going to say, oh, well, I do mine just as well, and I make a lot of money. But you really need to stop doing the root canal unless that's your specialty. Mm-hmm. The other thing, too, and the specialists need to take care of this, too, is once a root canal fails, in other words, pain comes back, pus starts coming out of the jawbone, big infection shows up on x-ray, don't do a redo root canal. You failed once, don't give the patient another 6 months to a year and a half of needless exposure to infection and toxicity just because your feelings were damaged and you think you can do a better job the second time. So there should never be a redo root canal, just an extraction.
Wow. So if you still have like a prolonged infection there, is that's going to mess up your tonsils there? It causes inflammation of the tonsils.
The tonsils are very weak immune organs. Mm-hmm. And when you have an infection that never resolves, which is like a root canal in your jawbone, they still are releasing some toxins, some passage into the blood. The first line of defense is the tonsil.
Yeah.
Okay. So we have some work done by Dr. Issels back in the 50s, but he found that all his advanced cancer patients, he treated advanced metastatic cancer patients with great success, but he found 97% of these patients had root canals and other infected teeth. Wow. 97%.
That's high.
And somewhere along the line, even though the tonsils appeared normal in all these people, he found out that 100% of the tonsils were abscessed and severely infected. So he routinely did tonsillectomy on these patients. And every tonsil, no matter how normal it looked on the outside, was grossly infected on the inside. Mm-hmm. Now, this is different from tonsils that have a lot of tonsillitis, okay? Those tonsils look sick. Mm-hmm. The same thing happened to me. I won't go into much detail except to say I had a chest pain experience about 6 years ago, mm-hmm. and I had read Issel's work. I had done everything else imaginable, and I went to the ENT doctor and said, take out my tonsils. I'm tired of having tonsillitis. Well, a surgeon doesn't need much of an excuse to do his surgery, so they did it. And he said, your tonsils look normal, but they do look a little enlarged. I said, okay, fine, get them out. Then after the procedure, I said, well, how did it look? He said, well, it's interesting. When I grabbed the tonsil on the left side, now the left side was where I had a root canal 20 years earlier, mm-hmm. the root canal stayed in my mouth for 10 years, and then there was a 10-year period after it was extracted where there was no root canal.
Yeah.
He said, I grabbed that tonsil on the left side and pus started coming out.
Wow.
Okay. So I completely believe everything Dr. Issel says in his book. And for people that are interested, his book is called Cancer, A Second Opinion.
Awesome. So okay. if someone wants to look at their inflammatory markers, what do you recommend they look at? HSCRP?
HSCRP or CRP is, at this point in time, you know, things are always developing. At this point in time, it's far and away the best way to see whether your infection, whether your disease, whether whatever is afflicting you is severely damaging your health long term, because it's a direct reflection of how much inflammation or increased oxidative stress you have throughout your body. Mm-hmm. And just like the ferritin, they say the reference range, normal range, is 0 to 3. Mm-hmm. Well, the real normal range is 0.5, 0.4, 0.3 or less. But practically the whole population has some degree of infection, some degree of periodontal disease, some degree of something going on, different diseases causing increased oxidative stress. So the normal range, quote unquote, goes up to 3. Mm-hmm. Well, There's no question if you have a 3 rather than a 5, you're much better off. But if you have a 3, you need to do everything you need to get it down to a 1 or less.
So this is for CRP?
CRP.
Okay.
There are other anti-inflammatory tests or tests that look at inflammation, but they're pretty costly.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't have the body of clinical work in research data on them that we have on CRP. So the simple way, and it's an inexpensive test too.
Yeah.
Even if you get it on your own at LabCorp through Life Extension Foundation, they have a blood drawing service. I don't know, I think it's $40.
Okay. Yeah, I've also got it on my website for clients to order, jacobtests.com. Do you know about atropine, the hormone?
Atropine.
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
Not familiar with that one.
All right, it goes up before like cardiac arrest and things like that. I was wondering your opinion on that, but if you don't know about that, that could be a little bit of homework for you.
No opinion.
Okay, no opinion. All right, so that was awesome. Your newest book is coming out soon, in about 3 months. Hidden Epidemic, Silent Oral Infections Cause Heart Attacks in Most Breast Cancers. I'm very excited for that. How can people reach you if they want to reach you?
They can go to my website, peakenergy.com,
mm-hmm.
and I'll even give you my email, but people need to understand I can't do consults on your medical condition, but I can answer questions about my work and sometimes give you references or even give you an ebook. So the email is televymd, TELEVYMD @yahoo.com.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Levy. Thanks, guys, for watching. And if you like this video, like it. And if you want to see more stuff like this, subscribe and hit that little bell to get more notifications. Thanks, guys, for watching, and stay beautiful.